On today's show, Ocean's 8 unseats Solo at the box office. Michael Myers is back. We get to talk about it. And that's one small step for man, one giant leap for young Willy Wonka. Movie talk starts right now.
See what you did there.
A contender for young Willy Wonka. There were three men that went into space for the moon landing mission. There's three men that are currently up for the role of young Willy Wonka. Ooh. It's neither one of these two gentlemen. No. That is Mark Yodi Reilly. Over there is John the Outlaw Rocha. I am Mark Ellis. Thank you, guys. Great seeing everybody in New York City this weekend. I had a blast both in New York and Connecticut doing a lot of stand-up. So many great fans. Y'all are the best in the world, and I'm happy to be back here in our cushy Burbank studios for a Monday episode of Movie Talk. Today's episode is brought to you by Rode. Right now, Rode has a really cool contest you can check out. Rode Microphones is proud to present My Rode Reel. It's the world's largest short film competition. This year, there's one $1 million worth of prizes up for grabs. Here's what you do. You make a 3-minute short film in any genre you like, and you also make a behind-the-scenes video that is showing a Rode product being used in the production, and you could win big. So go ahead and start cracking. Right now, entries are open until July 31st, and you can enter at myrodereel.com. Make a horror movie. Make a comedy. Make an action movie. Make a new release. I guess it's going to be a new release regardless of what genre you make the movie in, and a behind-the-scenes video. Get cracking right now, myrodereel.com. We have some breaking news up top, and if you're a fan of deodorant, you're going to like it. Isaiah Mustafar is reportedly been cast as the adult version of Mike in the upcoming It sequel, It 2. It's Isaiah Mustafa is actor's name. And if you don't know that name off the top of your head, you probably know the dude in the Old Spice commercials who turns into a manatar or a centaur on occasion. He's on a boat 1 minute, he's riding a horse the next. The commercials are great. He is great in the commercials. That's primarily how I know him from. Apparently, he's also really good on the show Shadowhunters. So Mark Reilly, hear this news. We're rounding out our It cast. What does Isaiah's casting do for you?
Well, it shocked me because of his work. And good on him, because like you, I know his Old Spice commercials, and they're hysterical. He is phenomenal in it. He knows how to pull the laugh and be great. I am not familiar with his other work, so when I saw this, I was like, really? The Old Spice guy? And that's a credit, I'm going to say, to Muschietti, because he knows how to cast. The It Chapter 1 was pitch perfect casting for the kids. So he obviously knows what he's doing. He's got James McAvoy, he's got Jessica Chastain, Bill Hader, and then the rounding out the cast with some people that I wasn't really aware of. You know, I know he had the fan casting. There was like Chris Pratt they wanted. A number of big A-list actors. I think he nailed three of them. He's putting it in with very good actors. I trust him. If Mustafa can make me laugh at an Old Spice commercial, where I look forward to an Old Spice commercial airing during the Super Bowl because of this guy, I think he can spin it, because his character in It Chapter 2 is very, very interesting. He's going to have to go deep. He's going to have to really pull some good acting chops. I think he's got it. I'm excited.
Rook, I think this is brilliant casting, and for no other reason, because if I'm Pennywise, there's one type of person that I fear, and it's somebody who has the supernatural ability to not only smell great, but also transform, shape-shift whatever he does on the Old Spice commercials.
Right.
Will we see that talent translate over to the movie?
I think we'll see some of that talent, and he has Terry Crews on speed dial, so that's even more scarier if you watch all those Old Spice campaign commercials.
That's right.
Because Terry Crews is even crazier than he is on those. But listen, I think this is great casting. I like this guy. I've always enjoyed his work. Whenever I've seen him pop up on numerous TV, he'll do like one episodes on TV shows, and whenever he pops up, he's always solid. And all the work he's done on Mortal Instruments, like that's got to be commended to a degree. You know, so many episodes doing work. So, and I think this is smart on Muschietti's part. It's a combo. You've got your three frontliners, like A-listers up there, and then everyone else coming in to really kind of shape the ensemble. You know, it's really great. They're all coming off the bench with their own credibility, and they're going to work well together. And I think it allows you to not be like, oh my God, it's an all-star cast. Who am I should be focusing on?
Right.
It's like, no, these are the three I focus on. Everyone else is filling in the blanks and rounding it all out, so it's a good picture. So they're going to have some great back and forth. What happens to Mike is like, so we'll see how that plays out and how he does that part, because I don't think it's a part I've ever seen him play before, that kind of stuff. So that'll be interesting. But to me, I like this all around. Good, solid character actor cast supporting the front people, and I think that's a smart move.
It's a great move for Isaiah Mustafa too,
yeah,
because if you're known as the Old Spice guy, this is the kind of role that will break you out of that glass ceiling, where now all of a sudden you're not just seen as a pitch man anymore. You're actually seen as somebody that has acting chops that can be a leading man one day. Yeah. And I think it makes sense as far as a promotional standpoint too, because you have a guy, very familiar face. You see the face, you know that guy, mm-hmm. but you don't know that he can do this. So I agree with Reilly. He's going to have to go deep, and I'm looking forward to seeing that with it too. The cast has come together. The movie's going to be out when it comes out. We're going to be waiting a little bit, but we got another horror movie to talk about a little later on in the program.
Woo.
In the meantime, we have the weekend box office tally and a surprisingly high debut for Ocean's 8, $41 million, aka the highest opening weekend in the history of the Ocean's franchise. It was started by Steven Soderbergh, George Clooney, and Matt Damon for the first three movies, and now Sandra Bullock leads the cast. Gary Ross directed this incarnation, and I think this is very interesting news because it made over $40 million in the United States, Rocha, and it just didn't seem like there was a lot of buzz going into this. I think that trailers got people excited.
Yeah.
Clearly, there is a much bigger demographic for this movie than I had estimated.
I thought we have to start looking at things differently now, once and for all. The female contingent is a powerful dynamic in films. People are going to these movies, just like Tyler Perry exposed, that African Americans do go to movies. They want to go see these films. This is, once again, this is just continuing that lineage. If you don't know this, Overboard has made almost $80, $90 million worldwide on a $10 to $12 million budget. That is telling you there's a market for all this kind of stuff. Even the Goldie Hawn, Amy Schumer film made a decent amount of money, and so did I Feel Pretty. So you're looking at this, and yeah, they don't blow the doors off the box office, but they're making solid numbers, and this is another example. And this film was damn enjoyable. These actresses were a lot of fun to watch in this film. And yeah, could you poke holes in it? Sure. But you can poke holes in every Ocean's film. This one is no different than that. And there was a lot of magic here between the actresses, and there was just a joy to just sit back and watch them work. And so this is a sea change. We talked about it with Bridesmaids. This is a whole sea change that's been coming for the last few years, and I'm glad it's finally happened. And of course, the Ghostbuster thing, people like to compare that, but it's not the same. It's a different situation. This is something else. And so I really enjoy what's happening here, and I'm a big fan of the numbers coming in, and I expect this thing to do well overall when it's done worldwide.
Well, it's interesting because the Ghostbusters remake had a much higher profile when it was coming out, and then there was a huge backlash because I think of the way that the movie approached the Ghostbusters, that it was a reimagining as opposed to continuing on the lore. This movie continues on the lore. Riley, do you think that was something of note for a lot of moviegoers, or that what was the difference between this being received so much better than the Ghostbusters reception?
Well, I think it was a better cast. I think it was a more high-profile cast. When you put Cate Blanchett, Sandra Bullock together, that alone is reason for audiences to look at each other and go, wait, what? And then when you put the Oceans tag on it and know that it is a part of the Ocean's franchise, and you get the mention of Danny Ocean in the trailer, where audiences go, wait a minute, this is a sequel to something, and it's all women, and it's women that are powerful and talented, and it looked fun. Yeah. And I think that's what audiences want. They want to see these great actors, Sandra Bullock and Cate Blanchett especially, or even just Sandra Bullock. I know, I always go, the prism is through my mother's eyes. She tells me straight up, whether or not she didn't understand Infinity War, she liked it, though. Right. She really liked it. What the hell happened, though? Everybody died. I didn't know what happened. She loves that. She wants to go back and see this. And then when Ocean's 8 comes out, and she calls me and says, Sandra Bullock, is that Danny Ocean's sister? Is she George Clooney's sister? I went, yeah, Ma. She went, oh, and there you go. That's the audience. And they went out, and just like you said, Rocha, yeah, we got to stop talking about it. If you put something out there for women, they're going to go see it. They want to see it and do it well. And Gary Ross coming in to direct this thing, yeah, it makes a lot of sense that this is doing well.
He recaptured the style of what Soderbergh had laid out really, really well, and got you excited for it. And yeah, the heist is the heist, and the twists are fun. Everything about it. And you've got different characters, different type of women from different walks of life doing the things that they're doing. And so that was enjoyable as well to watch in the film. And I think for such a loaded summer to come in and knock it out of the park with $41.5 million is incredible. And you're right, Mark Ellis, what you said earlier, there was not a lot of buzz, and that concerned me. There wasn't like big TV spots and big announcements and all. It was just a real subtle kind of thing. And maybe that was their ploy. It's like, we're going to be chill about this. We trust the movie. We think people people will find the movie. And we know there's a market on the female side and on the male side as well. The younger moviegoers on the male side were going in larger numbers, and that's a positive. So to me, all of this bodes well for how we're changing in the movie industry about who should be leading films and who should be in frontlining these films.
Yeah, I think there was still it was a nice marketing play for Ocean's 8. I mean, yep. We definitely knew the movie was coming out, but I think that they made a conscious effort to not try to oversell it like what Ghostbusters started to feel like, yep. Even for somebody who liked the movie, okay? With Ocean's 8, that clearly number one at the box office. I don't think anybody really thought a movie like Solo with, you know, right. All the problems that Solo's had at the box office was going to be competition or anything else. And I think that this does speak to the magic F word, fatigue, is that Solo, Deadpool 2, Avengers Infinity War, these are all giant blockbuster movies. And Ocean's 8, it's something different. Mm-hmm. It's just something different. And then we get right back into a family superhero with this week's opening of The Incredibles 2. Ooh,
yeah.
Before we get to all that, what's the rest of the box office story? Is it more that Solo continue to seize a decline, although it is number two, $15 mm-hmm. million. Dollars. For me, it's Hereditary.
Yes.
Hereditary, $13 million coming in. Deadpool 2 edged it out for the three spot, but Hereditary opening to $13 million. It's a horror movie, but it's not a popcorn horror movie that is easily marketable to a wide audience. Like, hey, go get scared. Hereditary, it looked intense from the trailers. Yeah. It looked as much like a movie like Mother as it did something like a Truth or Dare.
Right.
But the movie found an audience, and I think the audience that it did find is responding very well to it, Riley.
Well, it's also, you could say that based on the box office numbers, but it has a D+ of a cinema score.
Yeah.
So audiences are going out to, they're seeking this out because horror is kind of back in a big way, but then they're seeing this thing and they're like, eh, and they're it's affecting them. And I would argue that that is great.
Yeah.
That they are, I would argue that it's weird to say this, I would argue the D+ cinema score is a good thing for this movie because it is challenging audience members. And I've seen a number of people talking about it, that it's a horror movie, sure, but it's one of those that is like, oh my God, I've seen people say, I need to see this during the day so I have the rest of the day to decompress because of the twist. Yeah. That I love.
I want to walk out of the theater and have it still be light.
Yes.
That's the best way to see a horror movie.
I love that.
Really scared and then be like, oh God, how am I going to handle tonight? And then you walk out and you're like, oh, it's 3 p.m. I got some time.
And Clark Wolf, to her credit, called this on our Nightmares Heroes episode. She said, I've seen this thing. I'm very interested to see what is going to happen with the audience and how they're going to react. And she kind of called it. It was either going to be like mm-hmm. this kind of A and oh my God, everybody's talking about it, or it's going to be on the low side, D+, and everybody's talking about it. I think this is something that people are going to hear it and have to make up their own mind to go see this thing. Whether or not it's going to scare the bejesus out of you, whether it's dark or light out, or it's a D+ or an F or an A or a B, whatever, people are talking about this thing, and that's what I want. That's what I love that movies do, is that they challenge you. No matter what it is, if somebody says, no, I didn't like this thing, but then that's making you go, well, I got to go check this out.
Okay, you must have been a very good kid as far as like getting a bad grade on a test, but spinning it into a positive way.
I did.
For your parents, like, look, Dad, I know I got a D+, but it means that I was challenged in science. Well, Rocha, there is no way that a D+ cinema score could actually, or audience score could be good for this movie.
Listen, I've been super scared to go see this movie because of what my horror friends have said, Riley, Perry, Clark, whatever, about how they've pitched this film. And the trailers have drove me insane. Talking a little bit to Alex Wolf, you can watch our Smowdown match, like talking to him a little bit off camera about it. It all of it. And then you add the D+ cinema score, it makes me even more scared because it means people were walking out of that theater going, oh, screw that. Oh, no, this was, I'm unsettled and I need some time to process it. And so to me, that gets me even more excited to go see the film, but also crazy hesitant because I think it's going to mess me up inside. I could barely get through A Quiet Place. Listen, I have to officially admit, like, the horror genre is no longer some kind of niche thing. People are going to see these movies in droves. It's a powerful genre. I concede to Perry and Mark Riley now officially. They've been bashing me about this for weeks on end, months on end, how I look at horror, and you have to put that away. It is a viable market now. Blumhouse has made it viable, and I love that they're a part of all this. All these great horror movies, and one we're going to talk about soon as well. This is so good, and it's what needed to happen, I think, to take the genre out of this idea that it's just slasher films and really show that the great horror movies work because they're things that you can see possibly happening, or you can like somehow connect to and have thought about the possibility of happening.
So yeah, the horror, horror movies are always a reflection of what's going on in society right now. And I think I haven't seen her already. I couldn't get my fiance to go see this because of these trailers. She's like, I don't know about this.
Right.
She's like, I'd much rather sit by the pool this weekend. I'm like, how can you argue with that? But
that's pure
why I want to go with you this week.
But let's go.
Let's go because I need to see this thing. Because what I love about the horror genre happening right now is that there's so many different things going on right now. You have your Hereditary.
Yeah.
You have your A Ghost Story that came out. You have Split. You have Get Out. You have Halloween coming back. You have It Chapter 2 happening. Yep. There's so many different horror genres within, subgenres within the genre, and they're all doing well, and that just makes my horror ever-loving heart very happy.
A movie that didn't do well is Hotel Artemis. Made $3 million opening weekend. It was just not sold well. I mean, it had big stars in it, had a really cool premise.
Yeah, well, here's where I would say, did it have big stars in it? It had stars in it, but it didn't have like frontliner stars. Jodie hasn't really been an A-list star for quite some time in terms of being able to open a movie. She's an A-list actress and talent, of course. But Sterling K is just making his mark on feature films. Sophia Boutella has always been a compliment and also a good part of an ensemble, but not the lead of a film necessarily. Charlie Day as well. And Dave Bautista. These are all good ensemble actors in a piece.
Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah. Right. That kind of. So I think that, and I think people just maybe didn't gravitate to, you don't have a Keanu to hold on to like you did with John Wick and that kind of stuff. So I think that's what affected it. And plus, it's a glut of films coming out that, you know, you want to go see all these kinds of things. So I think it pulled it away. The one thing I will say, though, is Jurassic Park opening to $150 million worldwide before it's out. That's pretty incredible. I thought the market was a little dried up for it, but the fact that it was the highest opening for Universal Pictures in a number of territories, that tells you this film may come into North America, regardless of the reviews, and still do incredible work at the box office.
Riley, what do you make of the strategy to open Jurassic Park worldwide before it opens in the United States? Is it to generate a lot of buzz? Because I think the first time the movie played was actually in Spain, I believe. Mm. And it got this great buzz coming out of there. Mm-hmm. And so all these different territories that are getting to see the movie now, it's making a lot of money. Do you think that that's impartial, a marketing play to start to generate momentum for it opening here at the end of the month?
I absolutely think that. I was worried that we're not going to see a huge $200 million opening for this next chapter. I think that was a weird lightning in the bottle kind of thing that happened with Jurassic World coming back, having Spielberg back again as an executive producer, kind of pushing that mythology into the park is open.
Yeah.
And then you're like, wait a minute, oh, now the park's back. So I think, I think audiences went and checked it out and were having fun, like me included. Opening it overseas, that those kind of movies, monster movies, seem to do better overseas. So to generate that hype, to get that 150 million plus opening, I think only bodes well for domestic audiences. I think they're going to go, wait a minute, it's opening huge. We're going to go see it. I don't think it's going to open as big as Jurassic World. I think we're going to see it, you know, worldwide and all in.
Yeah.
It's going to be under the what did it make? $2 billion. It almost made $2 billion, Jurassic World, didn't it?
Yeah, I'll look it up right now.
Yeah,
it made under $2 billion, made $1.6
that's right.
$1 billion.
So that is incredible.
Not enough to buy Star Wars.
Yeah, not enough for Star Wars. But, you know, I think we're going to see a good-sized opening for Jurassic World Fallen Kingdom. It does. It looks good that it opened overseas, and I personally want to see a trilogy. I know that a lot of people didn't like this movie.
We're going to get it.
It's already announced. Trevorrow's back. We'll see. I can't wait to go see this thing. Opening night, get some popcorn, yell and scream, get people just... I like dinosaurs eating people.
I know.
It's good. That's fun.
I now understand people's anger towards me, the Transformers films, because now I have the same anger towards these Jurassic Park films, because they are
And I got to pull back on you. I do, because if I can like my dinosaurs eating people and just have a good time, you should be allowed to also go and enjoy your Transformers. So
he's had like 5 or 6 shots at this.
So have they.
Yes.
This is a rebooted thing. So Jurassic World, it continues on from the first one, and then we move on, and now we have Fallen Kingdom. Have you seen Fallen Kingdom?
Yes.
Okay, and you did not like
it? I did not. I stood up and walked out as soon as it was over. So yeah.
Well, most people do that.
Well, I had to say, because it was a screening, out of respect, but to me, as soon as it was over, I was like, and there's a moment where I was like, nope, I'm done. You could ask Cody. I literally said it out loud. I blurted it out in the theater. I said, "That's I'm done." And I couldn't.
It scares me. Some diehard Jurassic Park fans
are saying that too.
Remain nameless. Are definitely coming out going. You know, it's hard. I get it. I'm hoping that it lands a little. I'm going to go in, but people, lower my expectations going and right. just try to have some
but
fun.
But it's just not for me. Other people will love it. Other people love it. And so, and they're talking great and they enjoyed it. So I'm not in any way saying, no, don't go see it. Go see it. Go enjoy yourself. If you like Jurassic Park films, I think you'll enjoy this, I guess. But for me, it's just not my thing.
Okay, you heard it from John Rocha. Go see Jurassic Park, but as soon as it's over, get up and leave.
You don't want to stay in the theater. You can't live. They don't like it when you stay there. You're not
one
supposed to do that.
One more box office note is that Avengers Infinity War did just under $7 million worth of business domestically this week. It's interesting to note that Avengers Infinity War currently stands about $50 million behind Black Panther's domestic haul overall. And it doesn't look like Avengers Infinity War is going to catch Black Panther. That is incredible stuff to think about. A movie that Black Panther, which is a movie that is in the MCU, a number of other factors contributed, obviously, to its box office success, but then you had that movie and Black Panther's in Infinity War and all these other characters are in Infinity War, and Infinity War had such a huge opening, the highest opening of all time, but Black Panther just kept on chugging through February to March to April and beyond, and then Infinity War, maybe it's a competition thing, maybe it's just not as a culturally seismic event as what Black Panther was, a number of different reasons, but right now it stands at number 5 all time on the domestic box office charts. Jurassic World, Fallen Kingdom, or Incredibles 2? Which one's opening higher?
Incredibles 2.
Incredibles 2.
Okay. Yeah. Well, that was quick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well,
You guys have seen Incredibles 2. Uh-huh. I haven't seen Incredibles 2 yet.
And the reviews are off the
chart. The reviews are off the chart. I think that with Jurassic World, you're getting lit. There is, I don't know if you call it fatigue. Maybe. Is it fatigue?
I
don't know if I'd call it that because of how Jurassic World opened.
I think it's trepidation.
Trepidation and just being like, yeah, maybe it's like, and how many times can you sustain the same kind of concept with Jurassic World? Dinosaurs escape somehow and eat somebody and you need to stop them. That's every single movie. 14 years later, we're finally getting a sequel that was teased in the original, and it's something that Fandango blew. Their ticket sales went off the chart for pre-sales. I think that people want to see this thing. I think it's going to open huge.
Yeah. Okay, are you smelling like a $200 million, Rocha?
It's not out of the realm of possibility, to be honest with you.
Because the highest Pixar opening, I think, in history domestically is like 134.
I think it'll definitely beat that.
I'm thinking 145, 150.
Yeah, people love this film a lot.
It is so good.
There hasn't been a lot of films that have come out to take your children to over the last couple of months. So this is what parents have been waiting for, to bring their kids to see this film, and all the reviews being so great. There's no way, to me, in my opinion, 150 to 200 is absolutely possible.
All right. Well, speaking of Pixar, the Disney company announced that John Lasseter would be exiting at the end of the year. This comes on the heel of his hiatus for 6 months following sexual harassment allegations at the company. There were a number of statements that were released recently, one by Bob Iger, one by John Lasseter, just very flowery stuff, not hinting at the allegations at all, just simply saying that John Lasseter will not be with the company after the end of the year and that he's going to go pursue new creative challenges. So we've covered that story in depth with Lasseter leaving. Yeah. I think it's probably the best thing for the company as a whole. You cannot function at a workplace if you're not feeling comfortable from the guy who's in charge of everything. Where does Pixar go from here creatively? Do you think that this is an opportunity for Pixar, who has done very good business in their run, and a lot of that is thanks to John Lasseter? Where would you take the Pixar company now? If I give you guys the chief job over at Pixar, are you taking the company in what it seems to be right now is a more sequel-heavy direction? Yeah. Because remember, Pixar back in the day said, we don't want to do sequels. We want to continue to tell original stories. And then they saw, well, the sequels make a lot of money, and people are clamoring for stories in this universe, which is why you get an Incredibles 2. It's why you get a Finding Dory. It's why you get a Toy Story 4 coming out next year. Mark Reilly, this is the direction Pixar seems to be going. Do you want more originals, less sequels in the future?
I want more originals with a caveat that I want Incredibles 3. I know. It sounds very contradictory to say that, but when you have the genre that is within the Pixar subgenre of superheroes with Incredibles, having seen Incredibles 2 now, it just makes a lot of sense that you can continue to tell the stories with this family. It was so good. But then let me switch gears a little bit and look at what they've done with, like, say, Coco, Inside Out. I want to see more original movies out of Pixar. I think that's what they started with. I don't want to see a third Monsters University or Inc. I don't. As much as I am curious about Toy Story 4, the overwhelming response when that thing was announced was why? And I was with you on that because of how perfectly it ended with the trilogy of the, which I never thought we would be saying. A Toy Story movie, and part two came out, and then part three. I thought Toy Story 3, I was like, uh-oh. And then they managed to do something beautiful. But that's the thing about Pixar, and that's how wonderful they are. They could even take a sequel and make you cry, like Toy Story 3, and how Incredibles 2 is doing. I like the fact, one, I think Lasseter should leave now. I think it's just, I don't see why you need to have him stick around for a year.
I don't think he's hanging around the office.
I don't, absolutely not.
I think this is a way to gently fire somebody.
Yes, it is.
You know, because you don't want them around anymore. Mm-hmm. And this is the way when billions of dollars are at stake.
Yep.
Helps avoid lawsuits and all that crap. Yep. And you're just like, all right, you can continue to work here.
That's fine. And story consult or whatever that is.
Yeah.
That's nothing. That is a PR spin, I think. I'm looking at the two possible replacements that are rumored, Pete Docter and then Frozen's Jennifer Lee,
Jennifer
I believe.
Lee. Yep.
That's very exciting because what this does, this big, huge shakeup, what it does is it actually forces you to reinvent yourself. Mm-hmm. And you're going to now rely on some people that reinvented the genre with their own particular movies, like Pete Docter did and like Jennifer Lee did with Frozen. So you have a clean slate here to look at everything and go, okay, let's... Because that's I was watching the Incredibles making of documentary where they brought Brad Bird in and they actually said we don't want to rest on our laurels. We want to shake it up, and that's what Brad Bird is going to do. So they were already thinking about that in 2004 by bringing Brad Bird in because he was just going to get in there and you could see his energy behind the scenes. He was challenging people. He was yelling at people in a good way and getting everybody excited. And I think if you now focus on some leaders within the Pixar, Walt Disney Animation, shake it up, have fun, and I do say try some more original ideas and see what happens because that's how they started.
Yeah, Jennifer Lee is the top contender right now to helm the Disney branch of things. Pete Docter, the top contender for the Pixar side of things. I mean, when I got to go to Pixar and steal a lot of their free cookies, one was free, then I borrowed some other ones. It already seemed like a very democratic place to work where there's a collective of ideas. I think that will continue, Rocha. Do you agree with Reilly? If you can have one sequel, would it be continuing the Incredibles franchise, or do you want to continue to see? I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing for creativity if you continue to have sequels grow out of the movies that Pixar has already laid the foundation for. Am I on an island by myself shouting for more Monsters, Inc. movies?
Probably, yeah. Monsters University is not 100% universally beloved.
I don't want a prequel.
Right.
I want more adventures
with
Sully and Mike going forward.
Oh, Sully and Mike going. So not Boo necessarily, just Sully and Mike.
I want Sully and Mike.
Okay, fair enough. I understand that. You like being part of a two-man team. I respect that. You want to see more of that. I know. But look, here's the thing.
They're Incredibles the shows of the monster world.
That's right, the shows. Incredibles, I would love to see another sequel, especially coming out of two, especially if Brad Bird does it.
Yeah.
That's really important.
Yeah.
But here's the deal, and this is really important. This culture has to change, not just getting rid of Lasseter. Remember, Rashida Jones said it was a difficult time working, doing stuff there because she didn't feel like her voice was heard, so she left Toy Story 4.
Yeah.
Then you have the woman who was hired to direct Brave. She butted heads with Lasseter and left, and she said when she went to DreamWorks, she said, it's nice to be part of a company where I can butt heads and not feel like I'm going to get fired or I'm going to get let go. And so he was presenting a culture because they did a listening session. They went in and did a listening session with these employees, and they all said he was too domineering and pushing. And the thing is, if you don't listen to your employees when they're trying to tell you ways that you're not being respectful to them, then that's a culture thing that goes around. Now, do I want to see them clean the slate completely? I agree with Reilly in that way, but the reason I want them to clean the slate is because everything is almost is connected to Lasseter, whether indirectly or directly. It is connected to Lasseter.
Yeah.
Even the short, the bow short in front of Incredibles 2 has story consultant John Lasseter on it. And they said at the premiere of Incredibles 2, everyone was cheering, and then Lasseter's name shut up. Quiet. quiet. And that tells you people know about this and don't want to be a part of it. Disney's doing this because it's a way to save face in a way, and it's probably a way to save face legally and financially as well, because Iger at no point when he said Lasseter was leaving mentioned the reasons why in his statement.
Right.
He just said, this is why we're doing it, blah, blah, blah. So to me, I'm like, start over again. There's all these great new stories to tell. Our society has changed a lot over the last 5 to 10 years, and so all new stories need to be told. We're seeing with Coco, we're seeing with the two recent shorts. You had the short, the Indian short, and you had this, I think it's a Chinese short that we have now.
I heard it was good.
That was fantastic. So you see all this.
It made me cry.
Yeah, it does. So there's more openings here to do more types of films that don't have anything to do with Lasseter, and I think we can move all the, and those people are supposed to be creative, and it'll force them to find new creative voices in animation to come in and pitch them movies to do that aren't connected to what they did before. And so that to me is really important, and why you clean the slate, the reason why you clean the slate.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, you're watching right now. Let us know, what kind of sequel or original would you like to see from Pixar? If they make sequels, what do you want? Comment on YouTube right now. You can go to the chat room, check out our podcast feed. Do you want to see a sequel to Monsters, Inc.? Or am I literally the only one? Are you excited about Toy Story 4? Maybe you make a sequel to Up and you call it Time's Up. We have a trailer debuted over the weekend, and that stars Ryan Gosling as Neil Armstrong, and the movie is called, appropriate enough, First Man, as in the first man on the moon, and is directed by the Oscar-winning Damien Chazelle, and it is, you gotta make sure of these things. You say Oscar-nominated, then you lose two points in the schmodown. Written by Oscar-winning Spotlight and the Post co-writer Josh Singer, it is based on the James R. Hansen book that chronicled Neil Armstrong's life and matriculation to being the first man to walk on the moon, primarily the year 61 to 69, when he actually did walk on the moon. According to some people, he walked on the moon. I'm kidding. I'm not one of those people. I don't think I am.
Stanley Kubrick shot it.
This is Ryan Gosling playing Neil Armstrong. Yeah. You guys saw the trailer. Is this going to be like the next Apollo 13 from a dramatic, critically received, well, maybe Academy Award level movie?
I think it's certainly possible. I love this trailer, and I love space movies that are done well. And this addressing Neil Armstrong's character, and Gosling doing this interpretation of Neil Armstrong. You know, Neil Armstrong, every astronaut who has talked about him, they always said he was a reluctant hero. He didn't get into this thing to be a hero, to be seen, revered in this way. And so he is in his situation of what he's doing. And then you have Claire Foy as his wife, which is really great, having their back and forth. That moment when she says to him, You're not in charge. You guys are children. You guys are children. When she's saying to them, you don't have any, you're not in charge of anything because you can't handle what's happening here. So you see, there's going to be a lot of drama involved. And they show the fire, the Apollo 1 fire, which really affected him, the Gus Grissom fire. And so all of that going on, I think, is really great. And we shouldn't lose our touch to that space program. That space program was monumental in this country's history. And Neil Armstrong is a very interesting guy to profile, who has had a lot going on inside of himself, had a lot going on in his life that he did and worked on. And so there's a lot of things to explore with him. And I think this film gives you that vibe that they're going to do it right. And it's going to feel like my favorite kind of biopics, which are the ones that explore the flaws as well as the good things about the character. And the way this trailer came out, I was ready to walk into the theater after it was done. And that's a positive.
All right, Mark Reilly, do you agree with Rocha? Is this an Academy Award level movie, judging from the trailer?
Yeah, absolutely. I got some shades of The Right Stuff. Mm-hmm. I got some Apollo 13, and then you think Damien. Whiplash was my favorite movie of that year.
Chazelle,
La La Land was great. I loved La La Land, and I think that this is a natural progression for him. Mm-hmm. Based on this trailer, my God, does it look good. And yeah, I think we are going to, just based on his resume, every movie he's made has had some conversation of Oscar, whether it's an actor getting a nomination or his writing, which he did win for. Mm-hmm. These are the things that just have all the hallmarks of a guy that, and then you put up a trailer like that, which is, I'm not going to say Oscar bait. I just think Oscar voters like these movies because they are true stories, biopics, great acting, everything you said there, okay. Yeah, you got to dig deep. You got to show the highs and lows, the flaws for a character. Ryan Gosling, always a good guy, always just bringing his A game. This thing looks phenomenal. Can't wait for it.
All right. Well, Matthew Vaughn had some very interesting comments over the weekend about his universe that he created, Kick-Ass. I guess he didn't create it. It's based on a comic book, but the big-time cinematic universe. We love the first Kick-Ass. Kick-Ass 2 came out to mixed reviews. I enjoyed it. Some other people didn't. And now we could have more Kick-Ass movies. But first, we're going to get Kingsman film. So, Kingsman. He's planning a new Kingsman movie, a third Kingsman movie, and then also a spinoff movie for Kingsman that is entitled Kingsman, The Great Game. It's described as a look at the spy organization at the turn of the 20th century. And then while he was saying all this stuff, he also said that he wants to reboot Kick-Ass and Hit Girl and possibly have a Hit Girl movie. I throw a lot of news at you right now, Rocha. I'm throwing a whole lot of Kingsman stuff. I'm throwing a whole lot of Kick-Ass and Hit Girl stuff at you. Where are you landing on these issues? What should be the priority for Matthew Vaughn right now?
Well, obviously finishing getting that third film done is a priority. The Kingsman TV show is interesting. I like that idea. We can explore it more. I like this turn of the century idea for Kingsman. The Statesman, I'm a little lukewarm about Statesman. We'll see what they do with that. But I love the idea of a Kingsman TV show. And yes, reboot Kick-Ass. That second one, I think the second one was cut up a bit too much and there was more here on the floor. And I think some of that had to do with Jim Carrey's issues because of the gun violence that happened just before the, just a little bit before the film came out. And he kind of pushed to have this thing edited a certain way. So that kind of affected it. And Kingsman 2, I liked Golden Circle. I know a lot of people didn't like Golden Circle. I enjoyed Golden Circle, so I'm down for a third one. And, you know, Matthew Vaughn, these are his franchises that he brought to life. And, yes, of course, it's, Kick-Ass is based on a comic book, but he brought it to the screen. So, to me, I think he has a right to explore what he can create here and do here. And he has X-Men experience as well, so he knows how to put a team together to work on screen. So all of this, to me, excites me and gets me going for it because I really enjoy the Kingsman universe and what more there is to explore. I have no problems with that. A TV show can really go in depth about that. Maybe a 7 or 8 issue limit or 10, sorry, series, 10 episode series would be great to explore what you have within the Kingsman. And there's other factions of the Kingsman, obviously. And so there's stuff to explore there.
All right, Mark Reilly, are you more excited about the Kingsman possibly continuing into the future or a TV spinoff series or a prequel? Or are you thinking about Kick-Ass and if we need a reboot for that?
If I was a development exec right now, I would pass on all these, including a Kick-Ass reboot. Because I don't need them. I've seen what they did. They didn't land too well with me. The original Kingsman did, and I was very excited for Golden Circle. And then Golden Circle, I was like, oh. And if I love Matthew Vaughn when he is making movies that challenge him, and that when he's making movies that are different. And maybe I'm a little biased as well. When I hear rumors of a Man of Steel sequel with him possibly directing, that's where I'd want him to go because he surprised the hell out of me with Kick-Ass. Then he surprised the hell out of me with Kingsman. Then he surprises the hell out of me with X-Men First Class. So I want to be surprised again with Man of Steel. When I hear Kingsman and he's going all in and so many, I mean, now I'm like, wait a minute. Kingsman Golden Circle didn't do that well. Now, I know it when you look at all the profits it made, it could warrant a sequel. But does it warrant a sequel, a spinoff, a prequel, a TV show? That sounds maddening. It's like overkill for me. I'm like, how much Kingsman material do we need? I'm not interested in that. Same with Kick-Ass, when you're thinking, let's reboot it. Maybe do this. I could possibly get behind a Hit Girl movie, but continue it from the second movie and move on with a Hit Girl movie, or maybe look at the comics where I know they introduced a new Kick-Ass with Patience.
Yeah,
I'd be intrigued by that idea, but as far as him putting all of his focus on these two properties without branching outside and going somewhere else, that's what makes me hesitant.
So what you're saying is, once you come out the box with a good film and mess up a sequel, you shouldn't be allowed to do more sequels.
No, you can do that. I'm not saying that.
With dinosaurs. I'm just saying. So what you're saying is...
Oh, don't bring dinosaurs into this and have me bring up Transformers.
What's the more marketable play, though? If you're greenlighting this stuff and you're saying, okay, well, I can either have you do another Kingsman movie or I can either have you reboot Kick-Ass. I mean, if you reboot Kick-Ass, it's going to be a lot cheaper than making another Kingsman movie on the scale that you did with the Golden Circle. So either way, I think the budget should shrink a little bit because Kingsman Golden Circle, it made its money back in the United States and then it did okay overseas. But like here, the idea of a Kick-Ass reboot just doesn't seem that like, it seems like it's still too fresh to reboot or am I crazy?
Well, I think you do it. If you do it Patience Lee, then it makes sense. Because she's female and she's, I think she's African-American. So you have that different spin on it. Plus, when Kick-Ass first came out, we were a different superhero culture than we are now. So there's more to explore, play with, mess around with there. There's more to have. And maybe she has a male sidekick who's Hit-Boy or something. Like, there's just something to play with that's that fine. You can reverse it a little bit and have fun with it. And Hit-Girl deserves her own movie anyway. We said this on our news piece, or I said this on our news piece
yeah.
about it, that Hit-Girl is always the most intriguing character between her and Kick-Ass. Hit-Girl was always the most intriguing with the storylines, always more emotional journeys that she was going on than Kick-Ass was. So I like the idea of a Hit-Girl movie on its own. Maybe Hit-Girl and Patience Lee together doing something. That would be a lot of fun, because maybe he's too old to be Kick-Ass, or he's like in college or he's married or something like that where he's done with it.
Well, it all depends too on what Vaughn is going to do. Is he going to direct all of these movies or is he going to hand it off like he did for Wadlow with
yeah.
Kick-Ass 2? So I can get behind him producing it and launching these things and seeing, but just based on the numbers, Kick-Ass, Kick-Ass 2, Kingsman 2, they didn't just overwhelmingly go crazy and yeah. redefine the genre or anything. I think they're all fun, but they weren't something where I go, oh yeah, now I want 18 different spinoffs from yep. this one property. That's where it feels like a little bit of overkill for me.
Interestingly, the first Kingsman movie and the first Kick-Ass movie are the same score on Rotten Tomatoes, 75%, so
wow,
they're fresh. The Kingsman, the Golden Circle, 52%, so not
yeah,
quite
see?
Fresh. Kick-Ass 2, 33%
yeah. Yeah.
on Rotten Tomatoes. I may be on my island with that one too. It's just Mark's stupid little island where we got a little volleyball, we got some Kick-Ass, and we got some monsters in reboots. In the chat room, Edward Klein says Hit-Girl in the Kingsman would be awesome.
Oh yeah.
Christian Garcia says that he'd like to see not a reboot, he just wants to see another Kick-Ass and a Hit-Girl movie. And then somebody else asked if the moon is flat. Well done, chat room. We're going to save some time for your live Twitter questions
Kyrie.
At the end of this show, so go ahead and start tweeting us at Collider Video. Use the hashtag Collider Movie Talk. One more quick story to get to. Y'all probably saw the trailer. You saw some reactions online this weekend about the new Halloween movie. It's Halloween reboot-ish. It's a sequel from the first movie, and the trailer came out, and the first person I thought of was Mr. Mark Reilly. You got to see the trailer. You got to hear the classic John Carpenter piano tinges again. Did you get a special crawl up your spine?
Oh, I sure did. I love this trailer. I thought it was, not only did I love the trailer as far as the way it was edited, but the look at the way it was shot, that shot of going to the loony bin to see Michael with this weird kind of like little squares that they have to be in, my God, it looked, that to me gave me the creepy, oh my God, okay. I'm a little bit hesitant because at first I was like, why do we seem to be repeating the beats of the original movie? He's there, then he escapes, and then it says Halloween, and he goes on a killing spree. Fine. What I love, though, is Laurie Strode saying, no, I pray for him to escape. And why in the hell would you do that? So I can kill him. That is the switch that got me, where you are focused on Laurie Strode now, 40 years later, to the day, and his birthday, October 19th, is Michael Myers' birthday when it's going to be released, which I love. I love that little just meta thing. This looks just so much fun. It's Blumhouse. I like the fact that we're going back to Halloween to see if we can reinvigorate a slasher franchise, because it didn't work with Friday the 13th, it didn't work with Nightmare on Elm Street, and this is not a reboot. This is a continuation, which I think that was a ballsy move on Blumhouse's move to just say, you know, remember part two and Season of the Witch? Season of the Witch wasn't even a part of that. No. But all the rest and just getting rid of that, I love that idea, and I can't wait to go in and see this thing.
John Rocha, like Mark Reilly said, Laurie Strode in full Carol from Walking Dead mode,
yep.
ready to take down Michael Myers should he escape. He does escape in this trailer.
Yeah.
What do you think?
This is the most severe case of PTSD I've ever seen, maybe. I mean, she's still holding on 40 years later, hoping that she can go after this guy. And so to me, I like it, and I'm also unsettled by it, you know, because she hasn't moved on with her life. I don't know. I didn't see husband, kids, anything like this. So how deep did this experience
affect
her?
Well, she has a daughter her? And she's a granddaughter.
So we have Judy Greer. How did she find time to have that when she was like,
well, we'll see what her husband is. That's what I want to know.
I want to find out all this
stuff. You wake up in the morning, you throw some knives at a woodshed, and then you, you go to the grocery store.
You go on a date. You go on a Tinder date. Yeah,
that might be the horror they're exploring, is the horror of dealing with a knight like that she dealt with, that Laurie Strode dealt with, and PTSD that you described.
Right, and that's
and the horror of going down that rabbit hole, like every day you think of that knight,
right,
and then have to prepare, and then it turns you into an obsessed person.
Right.
And I love that idea.
That's what I meant. That's what I was, like I said, I was unsettled and attracted to about the trailer. The teeth moment, Lord, that was fantastic. Everything about this trailer put down my fears of the people involved in it, not understand, trying to make it too comedy-like, or really not trying to find the vibe of the first movie, which is the best of them, obviously, John Carpenter's Halloween. To see that, to see the way Gordon Green directed this, the shots above you were right, and reporters always messing with stuff, now for their own personal gain, to be, you know, get attention, bringing the mask.
Yeah, what are you doing?
What are you doing? But you accept that because you know some reporters like to do stuff that for attention.
Bring the mask.
Don't bring the mask.
He's poking the bear.
He's poking it. Why are you poking
the
bear?
What are you doing, buddy? And this is what I'm thinking. There is a huge, huge following for true crime stories right now, especially with podcasts. And you look at Mindhunter. I am personally a junkie for those kind of things.
Serial and stuff.
Serial, Sword and Scale is interesting, where the tagline is where monsters are real. And it's like stories like this of like Michael Myers. But to have that kind of look at it, I look at those reporters going in as true crime.
Right.
Things and investigating them and wanting to talk about it, and that's that. It kind of is a horror trope as well, where you look at that guy who pulls out the mask and you go, "You're gonna go, buddy, and it's not gonna be good. It's not gonna be pleasant for you."
Seemed like a bad 60-minute stunt.
Yeah,
yes,
like, you know, Leslie Stahl goes behind the mask and she brings the mask with him.
What were you thinking when you were attacking?
I can see the true crime story being like, it's 40 years later.
Yeah,
we are gonna go revisit this. He's in the mental asylum, and then he pulls out the mask for ratings. Probably that's where I'm like, buddy, you are the dumbest man.
Yeah.
So
like to see the late Andy Rooney. I don't know why you wear a mask to kill people. Yeah. I don't get it. Okay, I want to remind you guys that E3 is this week. It actually kicked off yesterday, and we're going to have full coverage of the entire event throughout the week. We're going to be covering all the latest games that debut, all the cool trailers for games, all the events, the news, a lot of cool stuff. And Jeremy Johns is in town. Did he get in town yet?
Yeah.
Jeremy Johns is here. He's on the floor, and he's going to be helping us cover E3. Oh, my God, that's him right there with Perry Nemiroff. They're going to be running around E3. So if you see them, say hi to them and ask them about all the latest stuff, and check out our new channel, Collider Games. You guys can catch all the latest E3 coverage on that very channel. On this channel, Collider Video, subscribe right now. Tell your friends about it, because later on today, an all-new Heroes hosted by Mr. John Schnepp is going to be up. And if you didn't catch the Schmodown Live from last Friday, it debuted. Make sure you check it out. You get a chance to talk about it. You guys probably enjoyed that a little bit.
No, what are you talking about? What are you talking about?
Make sure everybody gets a chance to watch it. And then we will move on to that. So we move on to our live Twitter questions, and we'll do a quick one here today.
Nice.
And that is a very simple one from Kieran Smith. And he says, what will be a surprise box office hit during the rest of the summer months?
Whew. Well, I guess Ocean's 8 is taken.
Okay, that's cheating.
Yeah.
You're not allowed to answer a movie that has already been released.
Roca.
I'm wondering how Tag is going to land.
I think Tag could blow.
It's one of those comedies that, it could be like, is it the next Bridesmaid Hangover kind of thing? Even Game Night, because it was so good. Game Night was so much fun. But to have it based on a true story, which is hysterical to me. I like the take on it. All the trailers are good. I'm looking at Tag as maybe being one of those comedy movies that are like, you got to go see this. We'll see how the reviews come out, though.
Yeah, I got a chance to catch Game Night again on the plane coming back from New York. It's so really good. Funny.
It's so funny.
I think Mamma Mia is going to be explosive. I think a lot of people are going to go see this thing.
I think you're right.
But I will throw another one in there, and y'all might think I'm crazy.
Uh-oh.
But I think Uncle Drew has a real shot
to
surprise
totally right.
people. Like, those trailers have been well received by so many people, thinking, no, this looks like a throwaway film that they actually find an interest in. And so I think that's certainly possible. And Superfly might do really well, a lot more than people expect. And so I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, Superfly, I don't see the marketing jumping out for Superfly the same way that I see it for Uncle Drew. But Uncle Drew had a great lead-in.
Yeah.
Because, you know, the NBA Finals, it's a movie all about basketball, and it really, since the Eastern and Western Conference Championship, I mean, that thing's been going on for a few months. Great lead-in to Uncle Drew. I think The Equalizer 2 is going to be big. I think it's going to be bigger than people realize. I think it's going to well outgrows the first movie. It seems like there's something in the air. But I agree with Tag, too. Yeah. I think Tag should be a surprise hit. If it's not, I would question how the movie ended up being marketed, because I'm not seeing all the maybe like press tours or like, you know, pop-up games of Tag, just things that you might expect to see with the movie coming out this weekend. So I don't know if they're just relying on it being counter-programming for The Incredibles 2, which it certainly is, but I am looking forward to Tag. Any other movies that got your eye the rest of this summer?
Oh, man.
Thinking The Meg. I think Happy Time Murders.
Happy Time Murders, I think will do well. I need a release, bunch of releases in front of me to kind of look.
Meg is going to break your heart.
The Meg is probably going to break my heart.
Yeah. 10 to 15 tops.
I can admit that The Meg is not going to do $300 million domestically.
And I think Tag is
275 tops.
I think Tag.
I've lowered the bar.
$275?
Yes. $275.
Cannot wait for that movie. Well, I'll be there opening night.
I think Tag's going to crash and burn. I'll be honest with you. I think the press for it hasn't been, like, you haven't heard much about it, and it's about to open, and I think it's going to get destroyed by Incredibles. I don't think anyone's going to go see it. I really don't. And I'm excited because I love all these actors, but I don't know. We had a surprise with, what was the one with Jason Bateman that was a surprise? Oh, Game Night.
Game Night.
That was a surprise.
Yeah.
It did a decent amount of buzz, but I think this is
got the director's the Flash gig.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't think this one necessarily has that same kind of buzz, but we'll see. I mean, you guys might be right, but I just have a weird feeling about it.
Crazy Rich Asians is another one that comes out in August, as does Black Klansman. I think that could be
Black Klansman is going to be.
I'm starting to hear a lot of buzz for that.
Yeah. The buzz at Cannes was very, very, very high.
So I was in a full theater for Ocean's 8 the other night, and when Crazy Rich Asians finished, the entire theater started clapping.
Really? Nice.
So that tells you there's a lot of interest in this film.
Okay, Riley, over-under. How many friends do you think Rocha saw Ocean's 8 with? I'm going to set the over-under at, it's not a giant, you know, comic book, superhero, Star Wars movie release,
right,
which generally will attract about 60 to 90 of Rocha's friends.
Close friends, right.
I'm going to go the over-under is 17.
17. Yeah. I would go under 17 because of the Ocean's 8.
Okay.
Right?
Now, remember, it was Pride weekend, so I went with 15 people. Yeah, so
there, I got it.
13, hey. 13 gay dudes, and me and my friend Sarah as being the only straight people in our crew.
Nicely done.
But it was a lot of fun. We had a great time watching that movie.
I like a man who stacks the deck. 13 gay men, and then you and Sarah, the only straight people there. Hey, you gave an effort.
What more can you do? What do you want from me?
Thanks for playing, Sarah.
I want to see that movie.
See you next time. Thank you to Mr. John Stephen Rocha, to Mark. I don't know his middle name, so we'll say Edward.
Sure. It's Edward.
Is it really?
Yeah.
It's Mark Edward
Riley. Nice. We knew this.
M. Edward Ellis. Thank you guys for tuning in. Reminder, on Thursday, we have a special episode of Movie Talk that's actually going to be from our podcast studio. We're going to take your live calls on Thursday. I'm going to be in studio. It's going to be a lot of fun, and I will have a very special Comic-Con announcement on that very day. We'll see you tomorrow for a new Collider Movie Talk. Hey, everybody. Mark Ellis here. Thanks for watching this episode of Collider Movie Talk. You want to watch more? Then click up here, or you can click right here for more great content from Collider. And if you haven't subscribed to Collider Video, do so right now and share this vid with your friends. Thanks for watching.